This presentation on Fit Poly is sponsored by the Tools for Genomics Assisted Breeding and Polyploid Training Workshop and funded by NIFA, the National Institute of Food and Agriculture within the USDA Specialty Crop Research Initiative, and was held on January 13, 2021.
There we are. So I'm going to walk you through a whole workflow where we go from array software output to dosage calling and in an input format for follow-up software like PolyMemR and so on. First, I want to draw your attention to the HTML file that is in the website. This file actually has all the code that I'll be running plus output and explanation. So if I don't finish within an hour or if I forget to mention half of it, you can always find it back here. But I don't want to read everything from this HTML file, so I'll do it out of my head. And I'll switch now to the RStudio. So what we want to do first is to copy a number of files to any directory on your drive, and set the working directory to that drive. The files are also supplied in the website. You can find them there. So what we do is set working directory to the directory where those files are. And something for Windows users not used to R is that in the path to the file, you have to use slashes, not backslashes. Now I want to see what files are there then, and if everything is well, it's these five files. So what do we have? We have what we are going to need in this workshop are two packages, R packages. One of them is Onkran, which is the default location where you can find all the published packages. And in order to install the Fit Poly package, you just can give this command install packages. The other package that I'll be using in this workshop is Fit Poly Tools, and that's not published on CRAN. It's basically because it's a kind of running collection of tools that I'm creating for myself. But the present version is also available in the workshop material. You can install that from your local file, which is there, the tar.gz file. This doesn't always work nicely, and if it fails, I also give here a little workaround that almost always, well, always in all cases I've seen it should work. But I'll now assume that both of these packages have been installed, and we need these packages to be the functions in those packages to be made available. So we use the library commands for those two packages. Then we have the data file that is produced by the Axiom array software. Axiom arrays from Thermo Fisher are one of the two brands of SNP genotyping arrays. The other one is from Infinium arrays. We have import functions in Fit Poly Tools for both types. But here we'll be working with an Axiom array. And on this Axiom array, we have a rows population of 172 progenies and both parents. And I made a selection of some 17,000 SNPs of the original array, which had something like 140,000 markers. So first we have a look how this file looks like. We import just a few rows, six rows. And if I look at the first few columns of this file, we see in the first column we see the probe set ID, which is a code for the SNP, you can say, and you see that each SNP occurs in two rows labeled with an A and a B. And in the columns, we have the samples. They also have rather strange names. They all end in .cell. This is, well, how always the files produced by Axiom arrays look like when you get them from the service provider. This is not the format that we would like to have. What we need for the dosage calling software, for Poly, is a format where we have one column with the probe name or the SNP name, one column with the sample name, and then columns with the ratio of the X and the Y signal intensities. And we have a function that's called read axiom summary. It's called that because the file produced by the axiom software is called axiom gt1 summary.txt. And this I will now run. Takes something like 30 seconds. Okay, but we are there, and now we have a look at the top of this of the converted file. As I said, we have now a column sample marker name, which has here you only see six samples with the first marker. So the first marker is this one that ends in 2744, which you can see here is also the first two rows are also for the same marker. And then we have sample names that are these ones here without the cell.cell extensions. And then we have the X and the Y signal intensities. And you can see that, for instance, for the first sample, 375 and 239, they were also here 375 and 239. It's just, this file is just reformatted in another format. What we also have are columns R, which is just the total signal intensity. So it's X plus Y. And we have the ratio, which is the amount of I divided by R. So the amount of I in the total signal intensity. Now, as you can see, the identifiers for the marker and for the sample are quite horrible. They are not the ones that we supplied to the service provider. So there, we need to translate these codes back to our own codes. And we have two files, one for the markers, which is called the CSV annotation file, .fv1.txt. That's also something that's produced by the service provider. We'll read that one and look at the top of that file. This is just a selection from the whole file. The whole file has much more information. Also, for instance, the probe sequences to identify the SNPs. But I show here a few columns that are important. The probe set ID is the one that corresponds to what is in the array file. So these codes here are also here. The customer ID is the name of the markers that we gave them ourselves. We also know that what are the two alleles of the SNPs that correspond to the A and the B, or the X and the Y signal. And we are going to use this file to convert the marker names in our data file to the ones that we use. And for that, we use this statement. So we are replacing the marker name column in .ax by something that we look up in the marker table. And we use a match statement here, which matches the marker name in our data file to the probe set ID in the marker table. May sound complex, But if we do that, it goes very quickly. And we can again show the head. And now we see that we have the same file as here, as before, but now the marker names are the names that we gave ourselves rather than the ones that were given by Thermo Fisher. Well, we do one thing to mention is that this CSV annotation file is provided also by the service provider. We can rely on it to be correct and to have a one-to-one relation between the probe set ID and our customer ID. No duplicates, no complexities, no missing data. So that's the reason why we can just use this simple conversion statement. For the samples, it's a bit different. The same array can be used for different sets of samples, different experiments. The sample tables are usually then made by hand, by ourselves, you can say. There could easily be typing mistakes, there could be duplicates, anything. So instead of using a simple matching statement there, we'll use a function that checks for all kinds of irregularities. So first we read this sample table. So what we have here is the sample name as we gave it, the material, the type of material that it represents. And here, the best array in this case, the column is called. That is the name of this sample in the software, in the Axiom array. A thing about the material, so this is a rows data set where we have an F1 population that is called the K5. It's not important. But so we have a lot of samples that belong to the F1 K5. And we have one sample for parent one, for the mother, which is P514A1. And we have three samples that represent the father of the population, these three. That's two technical replicates and the biological replicates. Actually, we had replicates for the mother as well, but it turned out that they were not actually from the same plant. as I said, for the samples, we do not use the simple matching statement, but we use a function in Vibcoding Tools that's called split and rename samples. It's called that because it can also split the sample set into parts. For instance, if you have parts that are diploid and parts that are tetraploid, you would probably like to separate them at this stage. Well, that's not the case in our data set, so we will not make use of this split function, but still, this function does a lot of error checking that we make use of. And when it's ready, it takes also a few seconds. Then we see that now our data set has not only a changed marker names, but also changed sample names. So now all the data are corresponding to samples and markers that we know about. So this is the main input file for FitPoly, for the dosage scoring. But we still need to define the population structure here. We need to tell FitPoly what are the parents of the F1 population and which samples are the F1 population itself. And as I showed in my previous talk, this population structure can be much more elaborate. We can have several F1 populations with different parents or with some parents in common. And we can have several panels, GWAS panels, each with different expectations for the segregation ratios. So what we do first is we create a parent data frame for this population. We make it a data frame where we I'll first type it. So this is the whole data frame, very small. So we have three so-called populations. One population is called the F1K5. And it has two parents, P1K5 and P2K5. And then we have another population that's called P1K5. And actually, this is the population of samples that belong to the mother of the F1 population. And we have a third population, P2K5. This is the population of samples that belong, that represent the father of the F1 population. And then we have another data frame is where we tell for each sample to which of these three populations it belongs. And we already saw that if we look back to the sample table that we read from a file, then we have already this information, sample name and material. So the only thing that we need to have is the first two columns of this data frame. So that's what we do here. We say pop population definition is just sample table columns 1 and 2. And the names of these columns have to be specifically sample name and population. That's a requirement. So we have to rename them. And now if we type the head to the first few lines of pop, we see again the same information. So the next thing is to run FitPoly. Actually, one function in FitPoly is called save marker models. It's a rather awkward name, but it's there for historical reasons, and I didn't want to change it anymore. So this function does the dosage scoring for all the markers, if we want to, or a subselection of the markers, and for all the samples, or a subselection of the samples. So what we have to specify is the ploidy, which is 4. In this case, for a demonstration, I only show it for 3 markers, because to do this for 17,000 markers would probably take us most of the night. The data are in .ax, that's the data frame that we have created. Then we have the parents and the population data frames that describe the population structure. We have here a P threshold. This means that if the probability that a sample has a certain dosage is below 0.9, it will not be assigned a dosage, but it will get a missing value. Then there's file prefix A. That means that all the files that are generated by this run of safe marker models start with A, which is very useful if you do several runs with different parameter settings, then you can easily distinguish them and compare them later on. RDA files is true. It means that the output files are compressed format. If this is false, you get text format data files, which are usually much too large to be practical. In this demo, I also want to generate plot files, which we'll have a look on later. And here I'm using only one computing core. Of course, if you have a lot of SNPs, you'll want to use more cores if they are available. This is parallelization, and the parallelization that is used in this function doesn't work very well in Windows, unfortunately, but it does work under Linux. And normally when I have large data sets, I run them on a Linux cluster, so it's very convenient. If you only have a Windows computer, it's better to divide your data set into smaller numbers of markers and run those separately in the Windows. And then you can run them side by side on the same Windows machine, because usually you have at least 4 computing cores. So you could run 4 R sessions in parallel. So we run this, it takes only a few seconds. And this will produce a few files. So it's already there. So we have score, the A, as I've said, so all the files produced by this run start with A. So we have A scores R data, and we load this file and we look what's there. So this is the main output file of FitPoly. What's there? It says for each marker and sample combination, it says what was the ratio that came from the data file that went into it. And then for each possible dosage, so 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, it says what's the probability that this sample has this dosage. So for the first line, the first sample, the probability that it has a dosage of 1 is almost 1. And so all the other dosages have a probability of 0. If you look at the, well, one with last line, you see that the probability of having being simplex, of having a dosage of 1, is not quite 1, and there's a small probability that it's also a duplex. But still, this is very clear. So the next columns are max geno, so that's the genotype that has the maximum probability, so that's 1 in the first row, 2 in the second row, 1, 2, 1, 3 in the third row. And max p is the probability of that dosage. So that's indeed what you already saw in the first few columns. And then the final column is the actual dosage call. And that's the same as max geno, provided that the max p is above 0.9. If the max p is below 0.9, then the geno column will show not available and a missing data. So this was just a quick run to show what happens. Only I'll also show you the plots that were generated. So here we have the directory where we are working. And we see that we have already generated the .ax data file, which is the converted data file from the array software with the replaced marker names and sample names. And then we have the A scores, A models, and A log files. They are outputs from FitPoly. I'll not talk about the other two files. And there's also a directory A plots. It's also created by FitPoly, and that has a number for each of the markers. It has a plot that shows, first the distribution, the frequency distribution of the samples. So on the horizontal axis, we have the signal ratio, and then we have the mixture model that is fitted by FitPoly. It has five peaks, five distributions for the nulliplexes, the simplexes, the duplexes, triplexes, and the quadruplexes. We show the parents, so the female parent is the red triangle, and the male parent, the three replicates of that, are the blue triangles. And we see for all the F1 samples, how they have been genotyped. So the samples that are in this simplex peak are all genotyped as simplexes. The ones in this peak are all genotyped as duplexes, etc. There's also one for the, there's a similar picture for the third. Sorry. So here we have a marker that's segregating in a different way. There's only two main peaks. And then there's also one that is rejected. That's the second marker, and we see why. That's because all the samples have more or less the same signal ratio. So it's impossible for FitPoly to distinguish multiple peaks here. And the one peak could be anything could be all nulliplexes, could be all. That's actually what it assumes. It assumes that all the samples are nulliplexes, but it rejects this marker anyway because it's not confident about the fit of this model. So, just close these again and go back to my RStudio. So, well, the demonstration was only with three markers, but of course we have to do this with all the markers, the 17,000 markers. And I have done that beforehand. With the prefix B, as you can see here. So the result of that run of Fit Poly is in B scores, not R data. I load it now. So one of the things that's interesting to know is how many missing data are there in each marker. Now use this statement here, the apply statement, which is rather complex to explain here. If you really want to know how it works, there's good help available in R, but I'm not going to explain it right now. So what this has, I'll show. So we see here for each marker, how many, I don't know if you can see it, how many missing data it has. So this marker has 76 missing data. This one has 9, etc. Now I want to see how many markers have 0 missing data and how many have 1 missing data, etc., etc. So tabulate these counts. And so if I look at the first few entries in this table, we see that there are 2,604 markers that have no missing data at all. There are 22,000 that I have 1 missing. There are 1,700 that have 2 missing, etc. And if we look at the end of this whole table, we see that it goes up to 70 missing data, and that there have been also 5,305 markers where all the samples are missing. Now, this is these last 5,300 markers are the ones that are rejected by Fit Poly. They can be rejected for several reasons. One is that Fit Poly is not able to fit any model at all, so it cannot do any fit dosage calling for that marker. That's usually the case when the marker is really very bad and all the dots from one cloud or don't return any signal at all. But it can also be the case that there are too many missing data. You'll see that the number of missing data goes up to 70, and that's because Fit Poly has a limit of 40% missing data above which it will reject the marker altogether. So 70 is 39%, and markers with 71 and more missing data are rejected because of this criterion. This is a criterion that you can specify yourself. It's not specified in the call here because it has a default value that I did not change. So apart from knowing about the number of missing data, we would like to know how well a marker is scored. And we can do that if there is a large F1 family among the data, and fortunately we are in that position. I'll first let a function call run because it runs for a minute, and then I can explain what we are doing. So we here define which samples are parent one and parent two samples, and which samples are the F1 samples. And we have here a function called check F1, What this function does is that it will, for each marker, look at the number of samples with dosage 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and see which possible segregation types fit, how well it fit each segregation type. So a segregation type is the segregation that you expect given the genotypes of the two parents. So if one of the parents has a dosage of 1 and the other has a dosage of 0, then you expect a one-to-one segregation of the two of simplexes and nulliplexes in the progeny. So for each possible segregation type, this function checks how well the observed segregation fits with it. And it does some other checks as well. And it has as parameters also, so it has parameters, of course, the scores, the scores that were fitted by FitPoly. It has the samples that belong to parent 1, and the samples that belong to parent 2, and the samples that belong to the F1. It has a polysomic. That means that if we expect polysomic segregation, so in an autotetraploid in this case, we should put this to true. And if we expect a disomic, so in an allotetraploid situation, the disomic should be true. Now, for rows, we know from earlier research that it's mostly autotetraploid, but there are some portions of the genome that more or less have disomic segregation. And that, of course, depends very much on which parents you use. In some cases, you will see only autotetraploidy, but in some cases, you'll probably see more disomic segregation. In any case, because we do not know this in advance for this population, we will have a look at the segregations that we can expect on the polysomic inheritance and as well as on the disomic inheritance. And we'll exclude for the moment mixed, which would mean that in one parent we have polysomic segregation, and in the other parent we have disomic segregation. We of course also specify the ploidy again, and we want the results to be saved in a file check one dot. And the results are also returned in a data frame that's called check one. So I think we are almost done. To wait a little bit, and then we can have a look at the contents of this file. There we are. So it's a wide file that is a wide data frame with lots of columns. So we first have a look at the first columns on each row. So here you have, for each marker, we have one row in the data frame with the marker name, of course. We have parent 1 and parent 2. These are the consensus scores, dosage scores of the parents, so taking all the parental samples into account. We have the number of F1 progeny that has been scored as 0, with dosage 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and with a missing value. And we have here the scores, the dosage scores of the individual parental samples. So the one sample of parent 1 scores a 2, which corresponds to the consensus of 2, and the 3 samples of parent 2 score a 3, as shown on the parent 2. For the second parent, we see that nothing is scored at all. So we have no consensus scores. We have 172 missing data in the F1, and we have missing data also for the parental samples. And then for the third and the fourth marker, we have again scores. So this is just an inventory of the data that that CheckF1 uses to do its fitting of all the possible segregation types. So what do we see here? Let's see if I can make it a bit nicer. Yeah. So here we see some columns further on in the data frame. Again, we have the same four markers. And now we have the best parent fit, which is actually the selected or the most probable segregation type. And that's coded in codes like these, and they need some explanation. So segregation types are shown as, well, the expected ratios in a segregation. So here we have the first marker has a expected segregation here of 1:5 to 5:1. And the third marker has an expected segregation of 1:1. Now, and which dosages are then segregating in these ratios? That's specified by the number after the dash, after the underscore. So it means that here the one means that the first dosage in this code corresponds to the simplex dosage. So this marker, this segregation altogether, it means that we expect 1 simplex, 2 5-duplex, 2 5-triplex, 2 1-quadruplex in the progeny. And in the third marker and the fourth marker, we have 1 1 0. So we have a 1:1 segregation of which the lowest is the nulliplex 0. So we have a 1:1 of nulliplex and simplex is expected. And then we have a few columns that say how well does it fit with respect to, for instance, the number of invalid F1 progenies. So here there is, it's 0. So all the observed dosages in the progeny are in one of these four expected dosage classes. But in the third marker, we see that there are some F1 progenies that are not simplex or nulliplex. So they are probably duplex. That is not really a problem because it's very well possible, given that we could have, anyway, doubling. So the next is the chi-squared p-value for the selected segregation, which are, nice, rather high values for these three markers. And there is a column that says, does this selected segregation match the observed dosages of the parents? And that's the case for the three markers here. And all this and other is taken into account in a score, an overall score, quality score of the marker that's called QOMULT, which ranges from 0 to 1, where 1 means good and 0 means bad and can be anything in between. So this is interesting information, because it tells us for each marker what is probably its segregation type and also whether it's fitting well or not fitting well with the observations. But there's more to do. We have also a function that's called correct dosages, and that's there because FitPoly, and I assume other software as well, sometimes makes a mistake. It can, for instance, happen that we have a marker that actually segregates only nulliplexes and simplexes, but where FitPoly assigns instead simplexes and duplexes. So all dosages that are assigned are 1 too high. Now this function correct dosages checks if there are markers where this is possibly the case. Just run that. And I'll show what is the output of this function. So here for each marker, we get a column that says what is the segregation type assigned by check F1, what are the observed parental dosages, do we think that a shift of these dosages is necessary? So a shift of one means that probably all the dosages should be shifted, or possibly all the dosages should be shifted one up. So nulliplex should become a simplex, simplex should become a duplex, duplex a triplex should become a quadruplex, and a quadruplex stays as quadruplex. So samples that were scored as triplex a quadruplex are now merged into a quadruplex. And there's two other columns that, that I'll not talk about today. There, all these outputs are described in the help of the functions in this, in these packages. So if you want to read more about what's in the output, you can look at it. So I showed here only the first few markers where there's actually a shift of not zero. So these markers are possibly, can be possibly shifted. So what we want to do now is to actually shift, apply these dosage shifts, and then run again the check F1 to see whether the shifted markers fit well or not. So what we do, we have this, this Cordos data frame. We now select only the rows where the shift is not zero. So that you get something similar to what you just saw here. We run check F1 again, but only on the markers that are in this selection where the markers can possibly be shifted. So we make a data frame subscores that is selected from the original scores from FitPoly, where the marker name is in the selected marker names. And we run check F1 again, and this is just about something like 150 markers, so that goes very quick. There, it's already done. So now we have a check F1 result of the unshifted markers, and we have a much smaller check F1 result of the shifted markers. And we need to combine the two into one big data frame. So the first one is check one, and the second one is check two. But check one, it doesn't have a column shift like the second does. And we need to add this column because otherwise we cannot put the two together in the same data frame. So we just add a column shift that has a value of zero for all the rows in the first data frame. And then make a new data frame check, CHK, by binding together, by stacking on top of each other, the first and the second data frame. And we order this new data frame by marker name, because now the markers, the corresponding markers with and without shift are very far apart from each other. It's just nicer to have them next to each other. That's done, and we write this file to a tab-separated data file that we will not use here because we still have the check data frame, but which is available for inspection later. So now the next thing we want to do is we have this QOMULT column, which is the quality column in the check F1 output. And we want to know which markers, which values of QOMULT mean that we have a good marker or not. So what we actually want to do is to have a look at markers, a few markers with a QOMULT of zero, a few markers with a QOMULT of 0.05, and so on at all possible levels of QOMULT up to one, and see if we can distinguish from which point onwards most of the markers look good. Now, in order to look at these markers, we must plot them. And we want to plot them with X and Y plots with the dots colored by the scores assigned by FitPoly. Now we have the X and Y signal intensities in the original data frame.ax that we created. We have the genotype scores in the scores data frame that was produced by FitPoly. So we first have to combine these two with the function combine files. This again takes some time because these are quite large data files. And after that, when that's done, we will create a sequence of levels of QOL where we want to inspect a few markers. So that's this sec sequence command of R. It says that between 0 and 1, in steps of 0.05, we want to create a value. Show that quickly. As soon as the combined files has finished. So now we have a file XY genome, which I can show part of it. So now we have the contents of the .ax file, the original data file, with the columns of the with the x and the y signals, also the RNA ratio, and also added the genome, so the dosage assigned by FitPoly. And now we want to draw plots. Oh no, we're not there yet. So we have this QL levels sequencing, the sequence command. So what does it look like? It's just a row of numbers from 0, 0.05, etc. up to 1. So these are the levels of the quality, quality criterion QL mult, where we want to inspect a few markers. And we do that by selecting markers at these levels with this command. So we take the markers in the check data frame. We use the QL levels that we have just created. And at each of these levels, we select 6 markers. And we draw the plots. So this command draws a number of pages, each with 6 plots. So the 6 plots that we correspond for markers at one of these levels of QL mult. And we'll have a look at these. So here they are. So these pages, they are numbered. Yeah? So you have page 1 to 21. So the markers on page 1, they correspond to the lowest quality score. And if we look at these images, we can see a little bit why that is the case. The plots don't look very nicely separated. They are some strange clouds. Of course, there are also some markers here that you could say are scored well. But if you look, for instance, at the marker here at the lower left, there's something strange. We see also some individuals that have a much lower score than expected. So at the lowest marker score of 0, these markers do not look very well. If you go on them, already at 0.05, these markers look all rather nice. And this is at 0.10, 0.15. So not all markers look nice, but as we can see, most of the markers that are not in the lowest category are looking quite nicely. So we will not discard them. And that was the whole point of doing this exercise. We want to discard the markers that are most probably not scored well. The conclusion was that we would select only the markers that had a QL mult score larger than 0, and that's what we do here. So the QL mult score should not be missing. So that's what in the first part of this condition, and it should be larger than 0. In both either case, then we select the markers. Of course, we now have both the shifted and the unshifted versions of markers left if both of them pass the quality test. And there's more duplication of markers, as I'll show here. So we have a look at all the versions that are now present of marker that starts with this code. So what we see here are, from this marker, we have two versions, if we call it that, that end on a P, and two versions that end on a Q. Now this corresponds to the two probes that are used on this array to interrogate a SNP. In the axiom array, you only need a probe from one side of the SNP to target it. And of course, that means that you can target a SNP from two sides, and the array will treat those as two independent markers, actually. So we have the P marker and the Q marker. They are obtained with the two probes. And of course, because they target the same SNP, they should, in principle, give the same results overall. But that's not always the case, not for all the samples. And sometimes one of the two probes doesn't work very well and the other does. That's the reason why there is a P and a Q version. And then there's also, for this marker, both the P and the Q have also been shifted. So we try the original version with a shift of zero, which results here in parents one having dosages 2 and 3, with in the progeny a segregation of 1-to-1 duplex triplex, which is something that can arise in case of disomic segregation, but not polysomic segregation. And that has a QL null score of 0.54. And if you shift it, then you get parents with scores 3 and 4, and also a 1-to-1 segregation expected, again, with triplexes and quadruplexes, which is something that can occur both with disomic and polysomic segregation. And this marker has then a shift of 1. And the same also for the Q marker. So what we now want to do is to come up with the best version of the markers, and if possible, combine these versions, especially the P and the Q version, because it could be that with one probe, some missing data are obtained for some individuals, and with the other probe, missing data results for some other individuals. So if you combine the two, you will get a more complete data set. And that's what is done in this function compare probes. Compare probes will take into account these two probes, but it will also take into account the different shifted and unshifted versions of each probe. And this is something that will take also 1.5 minutes or so. So if we look at the function call, so we give the check data frame, which contains only the selected markers. We submit the scores data frame, and again, the samples that belong to parent 1, parent 2, and F1. The segregations that are selected should be the same as we applied in the check F1 function. So here we have both polysomic and thus disomic set to true, mixed to false. And of course, the ploidy is again there. If we want to have output, we should supply file names here, which we haven't done. So in this case, you see the progress. There are 33 batches. We just have to wait a bit until it finishes. In the meantime, when we finish, we will have those merged versions that I talked about, as well as the original versions of the probes. So we have the two separate probes, and if possible, they are also merged. And of course, if we have a merged version, we can then discard the original separate probe versions of the same marker, because they are redundant. And that's what will be done in the next function call. And the result of that next function call then will also be saved to a data file, which will contain 7,195 markers, which I already know because I performed this this whole workflow earlier. And this file will actually be the starting point of the FitPoly, the PolyMap R workshop of Peter Berg that will be shown tomorrow. So then you will see the whole workflow from the original array data of rows to the linkage mapping. So we're almost there. Okay, so now these functions, they produce an output consisting of two parts. One part is called CompStat, so the comparison statistics. And I'll show top of this. So for each SNP, it shows us whether there is a P probe fitted. We see it here that the P probe non-shifted, it has this segregation type 1 to 5 to 5 to 1, starting at the simplex level. And the chi-squared p-value of this version of the SNP is 1, so very high. And there is not a shifted version. And there is also, in this case, there is not a version for the other probe, not a q-probe version. Probably because it was rejected early on by FitPoly, or because it was rejected by CheckF1, having a too low quality score. So then here are the columns for the merge. So there's no merge version, which is then called R, logically, after the P and the Q for the separate probes. So because there's just one probe, there's no combined version. And at the end, the last few columns say that there's one P version, there's no Q versions and no R versions. But for instance, the second SNP, it has the P probe unshifted, a one-to-one segregation. It has also a Q probe unshifted, a one-to-one segregation. And the two are sufficiently similar that they could be merged. So there's also an R probe. And that's composed from two non-shifted separate probes. So there's the two ends after this. And in the last columns, we see that there's one P version, there's one Q probe version, and there's then also one R probe version. So now we are going to remove the redundant versions. So in the second SNP, we have the P and the Q versions, which are merged to an R version. And that means that we can discard now the P and the Q versions. That's being done by this remove redundant function. And that produces then the final data frame, of which I'll show the first part. So these are the markers that remain. The first marker is a P probe non-shifted, the N. It has a segregation 1 to 5 to 5 to 1, starting with simplex. Then are shown the individual parental samples. So there's one sample for parent 1, there are three samples for parent 2. Then there are the two columns for parent 1 and 2, the consensus. And then there are all the columns that correspond to the F1 progeny. And this same for all the markers. So the second marker is the merged version that we just saw. It's composed of two unshifted probes. So therefore the two ends, and so on. Now we have only the F1 population in this case, and this whole F1 population was used for the quality checks. Of course, it could be that we also have other samples in our data set that do not belong to the F1 population. Then still we can use any F1 population that is present, and that's large enough to perform all these quality scores. And we can then apply the selection of the correct probes and the merging of the probes also to the samples outside the F1 population. That's not the case here, so I cannot show it, but it's a possibility that's there. Well, that's more or less what I wanted to show in this workshop.
This presentation has been sponsored by the Tools for Genomics Assisted Breeding and Polyploids Research Project. For more information, you can email us at toolsforpolyploids@tamu.edu or visit our website at www.polyploids.org. This project is funded by NEFA within the USDA Specialty Crop Research Initiative funding program.